It's a great pleasure to introduce Professor Patrick Jackson. He is someone that's been already familiar with the University of São Paulo because he participates on a very exciting summer school that occurs here every January at the School of Philosophy, in which a group of scientists and students from the world, people from Europe, from North America, from Asia, from Africa, that come here to deal with quantitative methodologies to address public issues. So it's a quite exciting school that I have I got familiar with when I started my tenure as a research provost, and it's a pity that not all corners of this university are familiar with that. And Professor Patrick will tell about his life, but I will just make two remarks about his current position. He is current Associate Dean of Undergraduate Education and Professor of International Relations in the School of International Service, and he previously taught at Columbia University and New York University. And I want just to highlight that he has a tremendous experience in teaching, and he was awarded the U.S. Teacher of the Year for the District of Columbia very recent, 2012. So I want you to give a warm applause to Professor Patrick. Thank you for coming, Professor Patrick.
All right. That echo is going to take me some time to get used to. All right. Well, Professor Krieger had asked me to start a little bit more personally, a little bit more biographically before I start talking about the question that I'm actually going to play with a little bit today, which, as you can see from the title of the slide, is sort of why one should do science in a world of quote-unquote alternative facts, which I'm sure all the Americans in the room are going, oh yeah, alternative facts, we know all about them. We have a whole administration based on them right now. But I'm going to talk a little bit about why you would want to and why it's still important to do science. And I mean science broadly, so I'm going to talk about that a little bit. But to respond to the sort of personal question, like, why am I here? How did I get here? When I was in the eighth grade, a long time ago, 1986, I was pretty sure that my future was going to be becoming an astronaut, right? I had had this as my general thing that I'd been interested in since I was a kid, and I had done quite a lot of math and astronomy and such, and was planning to, you know, go to college and get a degree in astrophysics and so on. So 1986, very important event happens in the history of human space exploration. It happened in January. Anybody remember what it was? It's much before your time, but you may have heard of it. The space shuttle Challenger exploded. So Challenger blew up taking off from Cape Canaveral. And this was a huge derailing for the whole US space program. And it affected me a great deal, both because here was this sort of big obstacle with manned space flight and the idea that I would ever be part of it, but also because of a particular passenger on that shuttle. It was Krista McAuliffe. Was a teacher. And what she was going to do was she was going to go into orbit and she was going to teach classes from orbit. And I thought that was just the coolest thing I could imagine, right? Not just being up in space and exploring space, but being able to teach from space. I just thought that was an excellent thing. And the explosion of the Challenger kind of derailed a whole lot of things. It derailed the US space program. It derailed a lot of the way people thought about sort of the role of science in sort of exploration. But it also, for me, kind of derailed my career plans. Because as I watched the politics around the fallout from the Challenger disaster, it occurred to me that something odd was happening because we had the science, and then we had the politics around the science that seemed to be diverting the science in all sorts of strange ways. And the more I did reading on this, the more I realized that actually human space flight was itself kind of a political project and not even necessarily the most scientifically defensible way to explore the universe. So there's something odd about this intersection between science and politics, and I really want to understand that. So fast forward, I end up with a PhD in political science because I'm trying to understand this interaction of science and politics and knowledge and politics. Now, when I went to get my PhD, the interesting thing is we were presented in our PhD program was an extremely narrow understanding of what science and the scientific method was, based on, I think, a kind of misunderstanding of what the natural sciences do. So then this led to about 15 years of me doing a whole lot of work in the philosophy of science to try to get a bigger and broader sense of what it actually means to do scientific research, what it means to have scientific knowledge. And it is on that basis that I want to talk to you this morning, to talk a little bit about the broad question of what it means to do science, why it's important to do it, and why we have to both respect the internal diversity of different ways of being scientific, but also insist on the distinctiveness of the scientific way of doing things. So it's this kind of doubleness that I want to talk about this morning. And they gave me a clicker, and hopefully it works. It does. There we go. Good, good, good. Is there any way I could get a glass of water, perhaps? That would be lovely. Thank you. All right. So, in talking to you about this today, I'm echoing something that happened about 100 years ago, which was a very famous lecture that was given at the University of Munich back in November of 1917, November 7th, in fact, 1917. There was a very famous public intellectual, sociologist, social scientist, political economist. He worked in a whole lot of different areas, a gentleman by the name of Max Weber. Some of you may have heard of him. And Weber delivered a lecture called Science as a Vocation. And in that lecture, what Weber did is tried to ask the question, what does it mean to do science? Why should one do science? What kind of person should be doing science in this day and age? It was part of a series, a public series of lectures, which in German is called Geistige Arbeit als Beruf, which sort of roughly translates to something like intellectual work as a, and I'm going to come back to that German word Beruf in a second, because it's kind of an ambiguous word, means a couple of different things. But sort of, what does it mean to do this work? What does it mean to do this kind of work in the world? And this is one of two lectures that Weber gave. He actually gave another lecture 14 months later called Politics as a Vocation, which I'm going to touch on a little bit, but it's not going to be my main subject here today. But if you ever get, it's in my bag, you can get editions of the two of them together. The two lectures are usually packaged together, so you can get sort of both parts of Weber's thinking about this. And the question that Weber's trying to puzzle out here is, I think, very similar to the question that we need to try to puzzle out. Why would one do science? Why would one do science when there were so many other kinds of things going on? The challenge in 1917 for Weber is, why spend time doing science? Oh, thank you very much. Yay. They ever ask you to do a big talk, get water first, because your throat gets really dry. At least mine does. Weber talking, 1917. So one of the big challenges, of course, is this is near the end of the war. Everybody could see the end of the war was in sight. And the question was, why bother to sit down and do science when there's so many interesting, exciting political things happening? Why not just rush out and do things in the streets? And Weber's argument was, no, there's a value to stepping back and contemplating and reflecting. Weber's time is not exactly the same as ours, but I think that the question that he asks and the political imperatives to do something other than science are still just as strong for us today. They're different in a particular way that I want to talk about. But before I get there, I want to spend a little bit of time just sort of excavating what it is that Weber meant and why I think that's useful for us. So, I think my Humboldt students probably can read this much more clearly than anybody else. Anybody else in the room who can Deutsch can probably get this. But it's important because the title of Weber's lecture in German is Wissenschaft als Beruf. And Wissenschaft is a very interesting word because it's usually translated science into English, but it's much broader than the English word science. Now, as I'm looking out at the titles of posters out there, it occurs to me that the way that the word science, sort of the way that word works in Portuguese, seems to be much more similar to the way Wissenschaft works in German. But the English word science is usually very narrow, right? English science usually just means the natural sciences. And the question of whether everything else is scientific, well, you kind of have to justify that. Whereas in German, it's easy to talk about the Geisteswissenschaften, so human sciences. Even saying the word in English sounds a little weird, because in English it's like human sciences? What do you mean? Sciences aren't human. Sciences are about like manipulating things in labs, right? Isn't that what science is supposed to be? Right? Or we can say in German, you could talk about the Kunstwissenschaften. You know, Kunstwissenschaft as sort of what in English would come out as art history or something. Right? So this is a much broader understanding than we might be traditionally used to. And I think it's important, because one of the things that Weber is very clear on is that what defines science is not a particular set of methods or techniques. What defines science is a kind of emphasis on careful inquiry, right? The production of facts through careful inquiry. All right, that as you know, being researchers yourselves, you know that it's not just a question of making stuff up. If you make stuff up, that tends to get found out in the course of the process that you are engaged in. Careful, systematic inquiry is the key here. So in some ways, when Weber says Wissenschaft als Beruf, he means something closer to scholarship, but I want to stick with the word science because, as we all know, there are people at the university engaged in scholarship that aren't really doing or don't think they're doing science. All right? There are people who do other kinds of things at universities, which is why I want to stick with the word science to sort of hollow out a particular place in the intellectual world. Now, the other word that I said I would come back to here is this word Beruf, which means a couple of different things in German. And one of them, as you see from the little career planning poster that I picked up off the internet here, is simply Beruf means job, right? What does it mean to do something as a particular job? So you talk about someone's Beruf, what do? I drive a truck, whatever, right? So that's that level of just occupation. But also the word Beruf has a kind of interesting religious resonance to it. The root of the word is rufen, which is sort of to call. So the idea of a beruf is also something that you are called to, right? Which is why vocation or calling might be the word that we might translate it with. And vocation, of course, we think about vocation in sort of the religious sense. My wife is a pastor. She has a calling. This calling bothered her for many years until she went to seminary and got ordained and then felt like she was able to live out her calling. Many of us, and Weber noted this, and I think it's still true, many of us who think of ourselves as systematic scientific researchers also do what we do because of a certain kind of inner compulsion, right? We feel like we kind of need to do this. There's a calling to it. There's a kind of mission associated with it. And I think Weber put his finger on something here with a connection between these two. Now, Weber, part of the reason he's asked to give this particular lecture in 1917 is because of this famous book of his, The Protestant Ethic and the Spirit of Capitalism, in which Weber argued that the secret of capitalist success, in a lot of ways, was the transformation of simple jobs into vocational calling, so people felt like they had to work at them as an ethical obligation. Right, the sort of transmutation of ethical imperatives into everyday life. That's a whole separate lecture that I'm not going to actually talk about right now, but just realize that that's the background here, right? This taking of this religious notion of calling and sort of spreading it around through a lot of social life is kind of what Weber's trying to get at here. And I think that's still true in a lot of ways, particularly if you go and choose a career that involves being a university researcher, because you don't make as much money as a university researcher as you would in the private sector. And what is the argument behind that? Sometimes it's, well, because you have a calling. You're doing something that you need to do. It's something you enjoy, right? So there is this sort of, there's this choice that's associated with this idea that somehow you are called to do this particular thing. The question it boils down to is, what kind of person do you have to be to do scientific work? What kind of calling do you need to have? And the other reason why I like to go back to sort of start thinking about this from the place Weber started is because Weber, being a social scientist, was very clear that you cannot talk about a calling to do something unless you talk about the social role to which you are called. So to ask about the calling for science or the vocation of science is to ask about the social role, the role of science in society. What is science supposed to do? All right, so that is kind of the place where a lot of the reflections begin. Now, what I want to start off with in terms of the way I want to kind of update what Weber had to say here is I want to talk a little bit about the things that define science as science. And I said earlier, we sometimes have a all too narrow understanding of what the scientific method is, right, or scientific techniques. And if I ask you to just kind of think about what does a scientist look like, you're probably going to think of somebody in a lab coat with beakers and strange colored things and, you know, fumes and other sorts of, you know, hazard signs and hazmat suits, right? That's the kind of thing that we think of. This is my science uniform, so not all scientists have to necessarily have lab coats. But what is it that defines science broadly enough that we could put all those different things that fit into that Wissenschaft category? So the natural sciences, the social sciences, the human sciences. What is common to these things? I think there are three characteristics that are common to anything we would want to call science. Probably the most important one is that what we think of as science is systematic, right? Premises and conclusions have to be linked together in tight logical ways. You have to be very careful with the different steps that you undertake. Contrast this, for instance, to how political speech works, where systematicity is not the important thing. Instead, emotional responses from different constituencies are the important thing. If you ever try to write up scientific results the way you would write a political speech, it will not work very well, because the criteria by which we evaluate a set of scientific claims is all about whether the links fit together, whether the evidence systematically supports the outcomes. Now, the second characteristic of science, or anything we would want to call a scientific mode of knowing, is that it is public. And by public, I don't necessarily mean that everything that is science is shown to the broad audience of the entire world. I mean, in principle, it could be that there are no secret knowledges associated with scientific claims. If I have produced something as a piece of scientific research, as soon as you learn the language, the technical language that allows you to understand the steps I'm going through, you have just as much right to engage in it as anybody else. There's a sort of democratic character to a scientific claim, that as soon as anyone learns the entry points, then you can engage in it just like anyone else, which is, of course, why there is such a thing as undergraduate scientific research, because you don't have to already be a PhD in order to do science, right? You can enter into it as soon as you know the basic vocabulary. And the point of that publicity when it comes to questions of scientific knowledge is that if I make a claim in a scientific context, it means somebody can critique it, and we can make it better collectively by all of us talking about it. Not all knowledges work this way. For instance, in a minute, I'll talk a little bit about other kinds of knowledge, including like aesthetic knowledge, right? Artistic knowledge doesn't happen in the sort of way that one can put it forth, subject it to public criticism, and then improve it. That's not usually what artists do. Artists express, and then when they have an expression, an artistic expression gets to stand there. We can still look back at art that was produced 300 years ago and go, oh yeah, that's pretty good. Look back at science that was produced 300 years ago, and what's your first thought? Well, we've learned more things since then. We've sort of moved on from some of these. Some of this stuff is still good, but some of this has been replaced by other things. All of which is to say, and to put it in the terms that Weber actually uses, that if you're doing science, some notion of progress is built in to the very discourse itself. Part of the puzzle of why one would want to be a scientist is why one would want to devote one's life to doing work that one knows will be superseded in the future by somebody else. You sort of can't produce anything for all time, because if you did, then like science would end. And that's not the way it works. We always have the possibility of more public criticism that will kind of move things on. The third characteristic of science, right? So science is systematic and science is public, but science is also worldly. And what do I mean by worldly? I mean scientific knowledge, as different from other kinds of knowledge, say religious or spiritual knowledge, deals with the world, deals with objects in the world, deals with things in the world, and how those things relate to one another. It does not deal with things that happen outside of the world, which is why you can't really have sciences of gods and demons, right? Because they are not objects in the world. They are supernatural beings. And so to the extent that we have knowledge of those things, they come from churches and they come from literary novels and so on, but it's not scientific knowledge, precisely because we're talking about things that lay outside of the world. The other thing that worldly, does this, oh look, the pointer works. Cool. The other thing that worldly says about science is that what we, science stops at the question of fundamental ethics, right? Because ethical claims are not claims about objects in the world, they're claims about the transcendent value of those things in the world. Science doesn't answer those kinds of questions. So, this is kind of the boundaries, the broad boundaries of what it means to do scientific work, but there's a lot of room to play within these. And let me just very briefly go through a kind of typology that I find fairly useful, thinking about different kinds of scientific approaches in the world. So if we think about the difference between sort of this is a top axis and then it's going to be a bottom axis and you're going to get have two, you're going to get a nice 2x2 table in here. 2x2 tables, of course, being the social scientist's best friend. And so I have a couple of those to sort of to walk you through here. So one of the distinctions internal to science is this distinction between, I'm using these terms, I'm sorry for all the philosophy so early in the morning, but this is, I think, the best way to approach these questions. We take the distinction between what I call phenomenalism and transfactualism. These are positions about sort of the role of evidence in scientific approaches. So a phenomenalist approach to doing science would say the only things that count as objects of scientific knowledge are things that we can measure, things we can touch, right? Things we can have some sort of direct connection to. A transfactual approach would be to say scientific objects aren't just things we can touch, they're also the theoretical structures that allow us to make sense of those things. Right? So this is sort of a distinction between do we think that, you know, motion is a scientific object, or do we think that motion is just a way of talking about the movement of objects? Right? That's an internal debate to science. Now, another debate, the other axis down here is this axis between what I'm going to call dualism, and then there's going to be another term down here in a second. But dualism is the idea that knowledge, scientific knowledge, is knowledge that you, the researcher, have that sort of mirrors or represents the external world in some way, that there's a gulf between the mind and the world. And if there's a gulf between the mind and the world, and the objects of scientific knowledge are sort of confined to those things that you can see and measure and touch, you're then in a position which I would call neo-positivism. This is a traditional kind of scientific position which involves hypothesis testing as the main way of producing knowledge. Because I make a guess about how the world is, I throw the guess out against the world, I see whether the world lines up with the guess, and then I figure out whether or not I'm going to keep the guess based on those results. Sometimes that hypothesis testing procedure is presented as if it were all of science. It's not. It's one piece of one possible kind of scientific approach, particularly useful for laboratory sciences, not necessarily useful for other kinds of sciences. So if we were to say the world is still external and we're going to measure the world, we're trying to represent the world, but we think we can know things about the world that goes beyond just what we can measure, you would be in a position called realism. And there's a lot of complicated stuff that goes into realism, but particularly for the social sciences, the main implication of realism is that things like social structures can be scientific objects. Because you can't measure a social structure, you can't drop it on your foot, right? You can't walk into it and bump into it. You just kind of know it exists because it makes sense out of these patterns that you're seeing in the world. And if you're a realist, you say, yeah, well, that's because it's a real thing that's actually out there in the world. There's some interesting debates in quantum mechanics about the reality of things that can't actually be measured but can only be inferred, right? And so there's another way in which we could sort of put that kind of science in there. All right, so that's two different kinds of science. There's a third kind. And the third, if we go down to that bottom row here, in the bottom row, what we're talking about here is an approach to science which doesn't start with the idea that the mind and the world are totally separate from each other, but starts with the idea that the researcher is embedded in the world. You kind of get this approach a little more commonly in certain social sciences, anthropology, for instance, right? The idea that knowledge comes from practical engagement in the world, a little different than the kind of detached representational understanding that you get in some laboratory sciences. The kind of science that you would get if you were a monist, but then you actually thought that you could only really know concrete objects would be a position you might call analyticism, which is where you design models and you use the models to help you explore what's going on in particular situations. Now, that's different than hypothesis testing, because if you build a model, an analytical model, think in the social sciences here of something like rational choice theory, you build a rational choice model, that's not a hypothesis. You can't test that. You use that instead to help you make sense of the particular behaviors that you see in the world. Social scientific models were all falsifiable hypotheses, then we'd have a problem with, say, the entire discipline of economics. Because everybody realizes that not every actual human being behaves like the people in economic theory. But economic theory is still useful precisely because it gives you a rational baseline to be able to use to make sense of things. So something different is going on in that kind of science. And then there's the fourth kind of science, which comes about with the idea that you're embedded in the world and making sense of it, but you can sort of know things that go beyond just what you can experience. And this is where you end up with what you might call reflexive sciences, which is to say the kind of scientific inquiry that says where I as a researcher am located is an important component of the knowledge that I produce. So that kind of knowledge always begins with a reflexive self-critique. You get this in anthropology, you get this in quite a lot of feminist work, right? The idea that where I am located in a particular power structure affects the kind of things that I see, the kinds of concerns that I have. All of these, I'm going to suggest to you, fit under those big three, right? You can read all of these things in systematic, public, and worldly ways. So when we talk about science, we have to make sure that the definition we work with is big enough to at least cover those four kinds of ways of being scientific. Now, I said there was a second two-by-two, because, of course, science is not the only way of producing knowledge, though it is the way of producing knowledge that is, for reasons I'll mention in a second, kind of preferred at universities. But if you think about ways of engaging in knowledge, right, we can also divide up different ways of engaging in knowledge based on, for instance, whether the knowledge that we have, I've been using that one a lot, let me use this one, whether the knowledge that we have is knowledge that evaluates what happens in the world, or knowledge that sort of represents what happens in the world rather than sort of advancing judgments about it. And then we have this other axis, the second axis over here, in which we talk about whether knowledge expresses values or not. So, right, so knowledge that tries not to express values, I know things sort of in an impersonal way, right? If I have impersonal knowledge that's supposed to be non-evaluative, then that's what we might call epistemic or, to use a different word, scientific knowledge. Compared to other kinds of knowing, scientific knowledge is neutral. It doesn't express particular sets of value commitments, and it doesn't purport to judge the way the world is being put together. It represents it. It talks about how these connections are, sort of leaves it up to the recipient to figure out what then to do with these things. Not so something like, say, technical knowledge. Because, for instance, if I am giving a talk and somebody comes up and gives me something to put in my ear like this, the technical knowledge that they have has already told them that there are certain things that have to be done in order for this to work properly and in order for you to hear me. So there's a kind of evaluation in that knowledge where it says the technique of doing this is sort of already set down. You don't have an awful lot of choice about this. If you want to do this and work the room this way, this is what you have to do. So that technical knowledge in that sense kind of helps you evaluate things. Now there is a bottom row, of course, because it's a 2x2, and so the geometry of that means we have to have a second row. And if we can think here about the kinds of knowledges sometimes that people have, the knowledges that we engage in, which express values rather than being sort of neutrally non-expressive, this I think is where you end up with like aesthetic knowledge. You know, you look at a good painting, you read a good novel about something. There's a certain kind of knowledge that comes from this, but it's knowledge that's heavily rooted in a particular perspective, right? Have you ever tried to read a novel that tries not to have a perspective? It gets really boring. It's like reading a technical manual, right? What's interesting about a novel is precisely that it's a particular kind of character, a particular kind of point of view, whether it's the narrator's point of view or the character's point of view. There's something very specific about a good novel or a good film that allows you to gain what you might call aesthetic knowledge of how things are, which is different than some of these others. And then that final category down there, the sort of evaluative knowledge that also expresses values, you would then get into ethical knowledge, knowledge of good and evil, knowledge of right and wrong, so on and so forth. Now, the kind of knowledge that we produce in the academy, the kind of knowledge that you produce coming to an event like this, the kind of things you produce when doing the sort of research that you do, kind of slants toward or is inclined toward this epistemic box. So and that's for a number of reasons, including the fact that when we produce scientific knowledge, right, what is the marker of scientific knowledge? The marker of scientific knowledge is that we wrote it down and got it published someplace, right? So there's a whole way in which the scientific knowledge itself is kind of wrapped up with the idea of being able to produce results that can be communicated to other people in verbal form. That sort of inclines us toward like this kind of knowing. So when we ask the question, what does it mean to do science now, what we're really asking about the sort of vocation of science and Weber's question, what we're really asking is, what is the value of doing this kind, producing this kind of knowledge, epistemic knowledge, in a world where we have to acknowledge, A, that there are different ways of doing epistemic knowledge. That was the first 2x2. And we have to acknowledge that not everybody in the world simply believes in the value of that. We now have questioning about facts and whether or not there are such things as facts. That's a picture of a hat that I had made up. Actually, I brought one. I have a prop. My fact hat. I had this made up for an event that we did an event that happened in Washington, D.C., which I'll talk about a little bit later, which is called the March for Science, in which we had a whole group of people out on the street marching, sort of with signs, many of which said things like, I cannot believe that I have to march for facts. I cannot believe I have to advocate that facts are actual things. But in this day and age, in the sort of politics that we now have, this has now become an issue. People now doubt that there are such things as facts. And in particular, people take the philosophical discussion that I've just sort of run you through for the last 15 or 20 minutes, and they misunderstand that discussion, as if the punchline of that discussion was, there are no facts and it's all just made up. That's absolutely not the punchline. Absolutely not the punchline. Because facts, the way John Dewey expressed it early part of the 20th century, what a fact is, right, a fact is not just something you say. A fact is the stopping point of some kind of inquiry. Right? You're actually inquiring into something and looking for an answer. There has to be that search process. That deliberate sort of questing after a defensible answer in order to get to the stopping point that is a fact. And when we talk about scientific facts, of course, we're talking about the stopping point of scientific inquiry, this systematic, public, worldly playing around with evidence and outcomes in which we are all engaged. So that's, the scientific fact is the stopping point. In order for it to be a stopping point, it can't just be an arbitrary, I'm just going to say this. There's something behind a fact. There's something that stands behind facts and holds onto them. Now, of course, facts are provisional. Of course, facts are revisable. Of course, you can have facts that then get superseded by different kinds of things as we have different theories and different measurement tools. That doesn't necessarily mean, doesn't at all mean that they weren't factual to begin with, because factuality, right? Factuality is about having consensus. I'm going to take this off. It's getting hot up here. But anyway, you get the point of my prop. Factuality depends on consensus. It depends on a consensus kind of standard of measurement and description. So if I were to look out into the room here and say, you know, how many people came to the lecture? Well, there's a couple different ways we could calculate that, right? We could calculate how many people came to the lecture by simply counting bodies in seats. We could also calculate how many people came to the lecture by seeing how many people RSVP'd for it. We could also count how many people came to the lecture by asking people at the door to count folks as they came in. So there's a bunch of different ways in which we could calculate how many people came to the lecture. As long as we agreed on one of those measurement techniques, then there would be a fact about how many people came to the lecture. And if we disagreed, we wouldn't be disagreeing about the fact, we would be disagreeing about the standards to achieve the factual knowledge. It's a very important difference. It's a very, very important difference. I mean, let me make it a little bit starker. What if I was to look out into the room here and say, how many people came to the lecture? Well, about 10, and then a whole bunch of students. Right? I could do that, right? If I had a certain understanding of people as being faculty and students as just being students. Right? Now, we might not like that particular standard. We might think it was kind of useless. We might think it was morally inappropriate to have that kind of standard. But the fact is generated by a consensus about a particular standard of measurement. Once we agree on a standard, then we simply operate the sort of measurement machine and we end up with the facts. It's not simply something we arbitrarily make up. There's a certain amount of discretion as to which set of standards we're going to use, but once you've agreed on a set of standards, then there's no more arbitrariness when we're talking about a fact, right? Because then there's a procedure for actually cashing it out. This does mean that facts are inextricably contextual. There is no answer to the question how many people are in this room without a specification of what we mean by people and how many. Now, fortunately, in everyday ordinary speech, we already have basic tacit understandings of what people and how many mean, so there's kind of an ordinary language version that we can kind of fall back on. That does not mean, again, that we can just make up an answer. It does mean that the answers we generate depend on the kind of conceptual equipment that we bring to the exercise. It doesn't make it arbitrary, though, and that's a really important difference. Because people often misunderstand this, and they misunderstand it deliberately for kind of political purposes, which I think is a real problem. So when we say something like, when philosophers of science say something like, facts are pieces of consensus knowledge, what they mean is that a factual statement is a statement that quote-unquote everyone can agree on, but the everyone is bounded by what you might call the community of practice, people who agree on the use of words in particular ways. People who agree on the use of particular procedures in particular ways. So let me give you an example. Let's think about climate change. Among all of the people who actually do scientific research on climate change, with very, very, very few exceptions, and all of those exceptions, by the way, are usually actually being paid by particular interest groups to speak on their behalf, you have broad consensus for the operative definition of climate change that climate scientists work with, that there is in fact climate change going on, and we can track it, and we can figure out how severe it is. And there is broad agreement about the causes of climate change. There's some internal debate about exactly how much particular human activities contribute to things, but pretty much every climate scientist agrees that there is a human-generated component to what we are seeing, and it is an important component to what we are seeing. If you are not part of the community of climate scientists, and if you think the words that they are using mean something else, well, then suddenly you no longer agree because you don't quite understand. But as soon as you get the vocabulary that they're using and understand the procedures that they're engaged in, you really can't rationally disagree with this anymore. Once you learn the procedures, once you become part of that community of practice, the facts make sense. It's when you're outside of the community and don't bother to learn what's going on in the community that suddenly you say, oh, well, clearly that can't be happening. Well, take some time, do some reading, do some work, see how these things are actually occurring. And part of this, and this is something I think that sometimes certain public presentations of science don't take seriously enough, when you give someone a factual claim, when you say it is a fact that, you are incurring certain obligations. If I say to you, it is a fact that there are 200 people in the room, then that suggests that you immediately have the right to say, okay, how do you know? What's your evidence? What are the procedures you've gone through? And even if I just say, there are 200 people in the room, I am implicitly saying, I did the homework, right? I did the reading, I did the measurement, you can believe me. If it turns out, of course, that I didn't, then there are problems. But even in just making the claim, I've taken on an obligation. Right, so there's a way in which the very sort of grammar of a factual claim is what opens up the possibility of this kind of public discussion. You can't just say something and pass it off as if it were a fact. And it, as I said, whenever you're doing this for a scientific fact, if I tell you it's a scientific fact, that means it is supported by research, it is supported by procedures, it is supported by the broad consensus of the scientific community. And if it's not to that point yet, we don't call it a fact. If not to that point yet, we call it a hypothesis or a conjecture or an idea or something like that. The word fact signals a certain kind of consensus across the community. And it's fortunate that it does so, because what facts allow you to do is they allow you to engage in explanations that are grounded in the facts. Right? Every kind of explanation that we would generate across different kinds of knowing, right? Explanations always come out of particular problem situations. They come out of things we want to get accomplished that we can't quite accomplish yet. So the reason why we engage in explanation is because you're trying to tell somebody how it is possible or how it would be possible for them to do something that they can't currently do. Right? So we got this picture of a bridge here, and you know, the problem situation is I want to get from here to there, and I don't want to climb down into the river. So there's a very concrete problem situation that shows up. That situation is what gives rise to the need for different kinds of capacities. My explanation to you is always about helping you do something that you couldn't do otherwise. So when we're dealing with an explanation that's supposed to be scientific, obviously we would want to use those three criteria again. A good scientific explanation is systematic. A good scientific explanation is open to that kind of public criticism. Good scientific explanation doesn't make use of ghosts and demons, but makes use of things in the world. Now, obviously, there are other ways we could explain this bridge than scientifically. We could explain it aesthetically. We could explain it ethically. You know, was it right to put a bridge there? But for what we're talking about today, the important thing is to deal with just these factual explanations, which are grounded in facts, grounded in problem situations and helping us do things. And I put up this particular picture of the folks sewing things just to really sort of drive home that explanations are grounded in practical situations. Even if the particular puzzles you're working on are kind of abstract things, if you trace them back, They are rooted in concrete, actual problem situations that people are wrestling with. That's the reason why they become interesting questions in the first place. So, broadly speaking, there are causal explanations in which we sort of are trying to answer the question, how do we make something happen? Right? How do we make the lights turn on? How do we make the sound work? Whatever. We're trying to do something. Now, the version that often shows up in our scientific research papers is usually not how do you make something happen. It usually shows up as more like why do we have this rather than that? sort of the standard counterfactual form of a causal explanation. Why X rather than Y? Why this pathway rather than that pathway? But those two are kind of logically equivalent to each other, right? Because if I know why we have, you know, growth rather than decay, that's also a recipe for producing growth, right? So logically, these things go together. Now, there are other kinds of explanatory situations, right? So not all causal. There are also interpretive puzzles, interpretive situations, where the question is not how do I make something happen as much as it's how do I go on, and that's a sort of technical term, that use of go on is something I'm deriving from Ludwig Wittgenstein, for people who are familiar with Wittgenstein. But what I mean here is something like what is the appropriate thing to do in this context, and a lot, especially in the social sciences, a lot of social science questions are about this. How do I go on? How do I act appropriately? How do I go on in this situation? Which is logically equivalent to what are the rules in this particular situation? Now, I don't want to be misunderstood. This is not natural science and this is not social science. There are natural sciences up here and there are social sciences down here as well. There are clearly social science causal questions. How do we make certain social things happen? There are natural science interpretive questions. There's a whole approach now to thinking from the sort of non-anthropocentric perspective of objects and animals, which says, how do we sort of go on? What are the rules of social interaction among animals? In fact, maybe what are the rules of social interaction among physical objects? There is actually a whole field in which people are investigating this. If you're interested, there's a lovely little book called Alien Phenomenology by Ian Bogost that I would really recommend to you. But trying to take a look at how physical objects can be thought of as having kind of interaction rules the same way. So, different kinds of explanatory situations. And as you're doing your research, you should think very carefully about what kind of explanatory situation you're actually responding to. What is the value of a factual version of an explanation as opposed to the one you saw on Star Trek Discovery last night? The factual explanation, right? The good thing about a factual explanation is it gives us reasonably reliable options. So if I have a factual explanation for a recipe for producing something, then this is going to give me a good set of suggestions for how I should go out in the world and actually act on those things. A good factual interpretive explanation is going to make sure that when I am in a particular social situation, I behave in the appropriate way. If it's not factual, if it hasn't been backed up by those kinds of systematic research, then I may not actually be in a good place. So the value of facts is tied up with the sort of problem situation of particular explanations. The challenge we now have, I think, is this widespread devaluing of factual knowledge. And the term that I think nicely encapsulates it is this term alternative fact, which was a term that was coined by Kellyanne Conway, who was a spokesperson for the President of the United States. And there was a dispute about how many people came to the president's inauguration. And there was the count that everybody agreed on by looking at pictures. And then there was the number that the White House was putting out. And when confronted with this on a morning talk show, Ms. Conway said, well, you have your facts, we have alternative facts. This, of course, immediately became a punchline for lots of jokes. There's a lot of memes floating around out there on the internet in which people use this. The problem or the particular challenge of an alternative fact, right? The particular challenge of this notion of an alternative fact is it devalues the entire scientific enterprise. The whole idea that there's anything distinctive about the kinds of facts that we carefully produce through systematic public worldly research procedures. And it basically puts all of that knowledge that we've produced on exactly the same level with things that people just happen to assert for the heck of it. Or things that people assert not just for the heck of it, but because they are things that they prefer. Clearly, the President of the United States would have preferred that more people showed up to his inauguration than had ever shown up for any inauguration in history. It would then be the bigliest inauguration. But instead, that doesn't seem to actually be what happened. But, you know, alternative facts, whew, Then we just start asserting things, and now we can say different stuff. The condition of possibility for there to be such a thing as alternative facts is a widespread devaluing of the scientific enterprise, a widespread questioning of the worth of scientific research. So Weber's question, slightly updated, since we are living, I don't think Weber would have even been able to conceptualize the idea of an alternative fact. Weber would have gotten very concerned about this and made some cutting comment and moved on. And everybody would have laughed because it was, oh yeah, ha ha, funny, right? People could just sort of make up facts. Ha, what a silly idea. No, now that actually seems to be the case. So the question of the vocation of science now becomes something like, why do careful scholarly inquiry at all? If the political currency of the time is alternate facts, why not just go start spinning our own alternative facts? Why bother to do the hard work of producing scientific knowledge if it's just going to run into these alternative fact type claims? Why do science in the first place? I think that's the real question here. And the traditional answer, of course, that science is the best way to produce facts, is precisely the thing that's being politically questioned. And I don't think, in terms of a way forward, that the best thing for us to do is simply to assert, no, science is true and that's all there is to it. Because, as we've talked about, there are different modes of knowledge in the world, and science itself is not one thing but is internally diverse. So as soon as you say science is the best, well, which one? Which version? And then you start running into sort of internal debates about who's really scientific. And I just don't think that's a particularly helpful thing to do. And it's not a particularly helpful thing to do because there's a bigger problem, which is the general devaluation of the scientific enterprise. So what I want to do here in the last part of the lecture is I want to just briefly talk about the sort of two traditional justifications for why one does science, which I think don't necessarily work especially well anymore, and then a third version, which is, I think, what actually comes out of Weber, and that third version relates precisely back to the endeavor of undergraduate research that you're all engaged in. So this is Thomas Edison. You can tell because he has a light bulb. And Thomas Edison is often upheld as being the sort of paragon of inventorness, right? He's the great inventor who invented all kinds of things. I was looking for a picture of Alexander Graham Bell with a telephone to try to sort of juxtapose to this, but Edison and the light bulb seems to be easier to find on the internet. So that's the version that I ended up with. The justification you will sometimes hear is that science is a good thing because science leads to better inventions. You can build a better mousetrap with science than without science. Maybe. But we know that it's possible to invent things without being rooted in what would be respected by scientists as the science. Right? Invention, you can tinker with things and come up with solutions. So science and invention are not necessarily completely one-to-one linked to each other. We also know that the kinds of things that get invented in the world are not always necessarily desirable ones. So linking the value of science to invention might be a little bit of a problem in terms of a sort of general social strategy. And of course, we know that science can be used to invent things that we find positively nefarious. For instance, the great scourge of people Facebooking through one's lectures, right? Where did that come from? That came from the invention of certain kinds of technology. Do we really want the value of science to be linked to those kinds of practical endeavors that people come up with? And in the era of climate change, can we really say that the value of science is the positive products that it produces? Sometimes those products have unintended consequences. So I don't think that's necessarily the best way to go about justifying science. There's a second justification for science. Anyone, people know who this is? Richard Dawkins. One of the world's most outspoken, you might call, fundamentalist atheists. Who earnestly believes that the main problem with human existence is religion, And if we just dispensed with religion, as his shirt says, together we can find the cure, that we would be done with these delusions, and we would then be in the sort of magical, non-magical, but rational, happy world of everything being purely scientific. We might call this the atheist crusade version of science, the version that that Weber talks about, that he calls this the disenchantment of the world, right? The disappearance of magic from the world, the replacement of superstition with other kinds of knowledges. Now, while we know now, or at least we should know now, that a lot of what was called the disenchantment of the world, the way it looked from one side, from the other side, looked like colonial control, and looked an awful lot like armed white people in ships showing up in other parts of the world, taking things, and then returning back to their little scientific laboratories, usually in Britain, and saying, oh, we've discovered stuff. So this disenchantment thing was not a uniform, linear kind of progress. And I think it's really difficult, really problematic, to hang our justification of science on the value of that particular project, since we know that it is not necessarily the case that either the process or the product of banishing magic from the world is necessarily good. So I don't think either of those two justifications really work quite as well as they did in Weber's time. There is a third justification. And this comes out of Weber, but it comes out of other places as well. This is young Weber. We get to see old Weber on the next slide, but this is younger Weber. And I love his beard. Weber has an epic beard. In the course of the Science as a Vocation lecture, Weber talks about the role of science as providing what he calls uncomfortable facts. Now, sometimes that word is translated into, at least into English, as inconvenient facts, but it's really sharper than that. In the German, it's unbequeme Tatsache, so it's literally uncomfortable, like it jabs you in the side kind of thing. So Weber argued that, in fact, one of the most important things that science could do is provide these uncomfortable facts, provide the kinds of facts which would make any partisan political position be uncomfortable. And the reason why science had the kind of unique capacity to do this is precisely because of the consensus nature of a scientific fact. So we could say, you, person who are articulating a particular position, set your position aside for a second, let's agree on certain basic procedures and measure some facts, and then let's talk about the complications that those facts raise for the position that you have. To put this in different terms, science, the way Weber articulates it, in order to serve this uncomfortable fact function, has to be what he calls a nonpartisan activity. Now, this sometimes gets mistranslated or misunderstood as if Weber was saying science is a non-political activity. What he means when he talks about this, and this is why that other lecture is so important, when Weber says science is not political, he means science is not the operation of state power. He has a very restricted definition of what he means by politics, not the kind of broader definition of like the politics of everyday life that we often play with now in the social sciences and in social theory. Science has to be nonpartisan to serve this goal, this goal of raising uncomfortable facts, this goal of forcing people into what Weber called value clarification. So I have a particular position that I am articulating that's grounded in a set of values. That position, because it is a value position, has certain facts about the world that make that are problematic for it. The value of science is to raise precisely those uncomfortable facts so that then I have to reflect on my values and whether my values are really worth the cost that it would take to implement them in the world. That's the role that science can play. By raising these facts and raising them in a way that they can't just be dismissed, because as I said, they're grounded in systematic research procedures rather than in political positions. So scientific consensus, right, the consensus of people who are systematically involved in generating factual information, factual explanation, doesn't end politics. What it does is it steers political and social debate. you want to implement this policy, I'm going to tell you what the likely consequences of you implementing this policy would be. You make the decision, but I'm just going to tell you factually what I think the outcome is going to look like. You would like to generate a social order in which there is greater equality of income among different segments of the population. Great. Here are some factual explanations of ways in which you could do that. Now you, politicians, have to figure out which are the costs that you want to bear in order to bring this about. But what the science can do, what the facts can do, is help someone who comes into that saying, the only way to have equality of income is state-sponsored redistribution of income. Well, the proper role of the scientist at this point is to say, all right, let's take that value you have, state-sponsored redistribution of income, and let's talk about some of the uncomfortable facts that are raised if you actually just go down that route. Are you willing to bear the cost of that? And at the same time, somebody else comes in and says, the only way to have better income distribution is to have freer markets and get the state out of it and let everything happen by competition. You say, okay, well, let's talk about the facts of what those kinds of policies would raise and make you think about whether your values are worth those costs. Science as a form of clarification, not as a form of ending politics, as a form of informing politics, as a way of steering political debate. And remember when we try to do this that not every controversy can actually be resolved scientifically. Sometimes with value clarification you get to the point where there's just a clash of values and there's no more facts at issue because you're just talking about radically different visions of, say, what justice is or what the polity is or what humanity is. Science can't resolve every question. Properly understanding science, properly understanding the limits of science, is to say, well, we don't push science further than it can go. We can come up with facts, we can come up with factual explanations, we can inform and enrich political debates and ethical controversies and aesthetic work, but ultimately we can't resolve those things because there are other kinds of questions out there in the world that cannot be resolved by science. So part of the challenge in making the right case for science, for the vocation of science, is not making too much of a case. Right? Not trying to say science solves everything, because it doesn't. Not everything is a scientific question. So instilling respect for facts, I don't know if you can actually read the text on this. This is a San Francisco clothing company called Beta Brand, which decided to play around with the alternative fact notion. So their little tagline over here is another milestone for the company that invented pants and the wheel. Now you can say anything. Hey, why not? Alternative facts. Let's have fun with it. This is the kind of internetness of the notion of the alternative fact. And yes, it's kind of humorous, but on the other hand, it's sort of disturbing. It's like, this has now become enough of a piece of political currency that we have to really worry about it. How do you instill respect for facts? Well, I don't think simply saying the facts are more useful is going to work unless we are all agreed on a particular practical context. And we don't all agree on that practical context, so I'm not sure that that's the most helpful way to do it. And I don't think facts are just true because there is no God is the right way to go either, that atheist crusade disenchantment. I don't think either of those are really the right ways to go about justifying the role of scientific research in contemporary life. Instead, I think, I will argue, I'd like you to consider that the best way to think about the vocation for science and the distinctive value of scientific research, that the role of science, the distinctive value of science, is that scientific research gives us the broadest justifiable intersubjective agreement about facts. It gives us a shared context within which to have political debates. There are no such things as alternative facts. In the particular segment where Kellyanne Conway came up with the notion of an alternative fact, her interviewer said, well, alternative facts are just lies. And there's something to that, but I think the more, even more insightful and incisive way of thinking about this is that alternative facts are like counterfeit money. I give you something that's an alternative fact, and you treat it as if it were a fact because I've presented it as if it were a factual claim. Same thing as if I pass off a counterfeit $20 note, right? If I pass something off and you say, oh, I think this is real money. The thing with an alternative fact is it doesn't have that kind of systematic research behind it. So what is our response as scientists? What needs to be our response as scientists? Part of our response, I mentioned this March for Science that I was engaged in that I, you know, made my hat up for. Getting to the big finish, so I need my prop again. The March for Science was a time in which people came out and said, we're going to march for facts. We're going to demonstrate that, you know, facts are important and people actually need to listen to the facts. And that kind of public advocacy, one of the questions that people wrestled with a lot on that day is, well, what exactly are we doing here? The characterization of the March for Science by forces that were opposed to it was that it was some sort of political position. I want to suggest it's absolutely not a political position. Insisting on facts, insisting that what we do as scientists is try to produce these disinterested interventions, these public intellectual interventions, that we do that, not just we, the professional researchers, but you, the undergraduate researchers as well. You have the same kinds of scientific capacities. You've acquired the same sorts of aptitudes and habits of mind through doing your research as we have. It's just that we get paid for doing them and you're still students. But it's the same continuity, it's a continuity of aptitudes and capacities. And you can take those aptitudes and capacities out into the world, making interventions but also pressing for clarifications. So if somebody articulates something that is an alternative fact, well, if we keep on our science hat here, see, I told you that was a punchline, then what we would ask for is we'd say, well, what's the evidence? What have you done? Press for clarification. You've purported that to be a fact. You've said that. Now you need to actually show me the work that you've done that actually goes into this. Pressing for those kinds of clarifications, you know the value of those clarifications because you've been engaged in doing research. You know how hard it is to actually generate a solid piece of factual information. You know that this is a non-arbitrary process. You know this is something that you have to actually be committed to. So if someone is out there peddling things as facts, which are, to use the extremely technical philosophical term for them, bullshit, then what you can do, you know that, you know there's a problem, and if that should bother you. Hey, you're taking away, you're devaluing all the effort I put in to generate the few hard-won pieces of factual information and factual explanations that I feel comfortable with. You don't have the right to do that, so I'm going to push you on that. Right? That is part of the role that we can play. Insisting on logic, insisting on evidence, treating our public interaction in the world as if the world were in some way a large classroom, and not a classroom in which what was supposed to happen is the person at the front of the lectern is supposed to preach and everybody else is supposed to say amen. That's not a classroom, that's a church, that's a whole different thing. In a classroom, right, how does good teaching work? Good teaching works by making you think. Good teaching works by making you reconsider your own commitments, to go over the kinds of things that you hold to be true. You know that as a student in a classroom. We know that as faculty in the classroom. That's the same kind of attitude that we should take with us outside of the classroom into the broader political and social sphere. Weber's suggestion was that the person with a vocation for science is the person who has the deep inner drive to, as he said, serve only the thing, to be devoted to the subject, in a sense to love the subject enough that you won't brook compromise and you'll insist on firm, systematic procedures. That same kind of passion, that same kind of commitment, the one that should make us pissed off when people peddle garbage as if it were scientific fact, that is exactly the sort of thing that should fuel us, all of us, to go out into the world and insist on the value of science, of facts, and of factual explanations. And that is the vocation for science now. Thank you.
Something that we've been worried about at our office is science outreach, basically because we learned that through some very serious widespread national problems actually, that scientific literacy is a great problem, and we thought that one of the main ways to address that would be through science outreach. Mm-hmm. But do you have any insights and any thoughts on how to do that effectively? Because most of the time we realize that we're doing science outreach to whomever already has a basic understanding of how things work. So we're preaching to the converted. Right. So any thoughts on how we could do that more effectively to people that aren't generally interested in science?
Yeah, the preaching to the converted or preaching to the choir problem is perennial when it comes to this. And part of it is because, right, we as researchers, right, we as student researchers and professional researchers, we are enmeshed in a certain kind of practical context where we already kind of understand not just particular factual details, but we understand the procedures that each other are using. So, you know, if I go to a presentation of someone who is doing an econometric analysis of something, I don't do econometrics, but I know enough about how econometrics works that I can follow what's going on and say, oh, well, how does this piece connect to that piece, and where's the proof of this, and so on. And I would hope that an econometrics person would be able to go to a presentation that was a piece of literary criticism and be able to have, even though they don't do that, to have some sense of, like, no, this is what the goal of the exercise is. Once you get outside that shared practical context, then it's a lot harder. And the temptation, I think, in a lot of science outreach or science education is for us to take the easily portable things, which are the results of our research, and simply give them out like candy. You know, here's a fact. The problem with that is if the recipients don't have a sense of the context, then the value of what you're offering to them isn't clear. It isn't apparent. So at least in terms of the way I think about this, and sometimes I'll do this when I'm talking to groups that are, because my field is international studies, right? So I'm talking about foreign relations and the way governments interact with each other and such. And lots of people don't have practical experience of how that works. So sometimes what I will do when I'm going and giving a talk about, you know, what is the U.S. going to, you know, should the Transatlantic Alliance survive? Should the United States keep investing in NATO? And I will start off with a group of people and I will say, okay, so let's not start talking about NATO. Let's start talking about interpersonal relations and the difference between acquaintances and friends. And let's start with something that's there in your practical everyday life and show how those things then can become the foundation for thinking about these questions, right? So trying to connect, not just giving the facts. I can certainly give the facts about whether the US should stay invested in NATO. The answer is yes, and there's lots of reasons why. But how much more effective is it if I treat it as a classroom and say, well, let's start off with your interactions among yourselves with each other, your own senses of state authority, and we'll start from there and kind of build up. What are you doing when you engage in that? You're helping the audience develop the critical capacity to appreciate the facts, which you will then give to them later on. So there has to be a pedagogical element to this. One of the ways, at least in the US, that this gets done, but in a very narrow way with the natural sciences, is with children's science museums, hands-on museums where people go in and they're supposed to sort of practice things. The problem, of course, is that many of those have turned into for-profit enterprises, so they're much more about fun than about actually learning anything. There's a large exception, which is, of course, also about making money, but is a pretty good model. The Discovery Pavilion at Epcot Center at Walt Disney World. And the reason why I hold that one up in particular is because the way they do the Discovery Pavilion is they bring in various sciences and industrial folks who are actually working with things, and they have them set up these demonstrations. But they have not a syllabus, but a rubric of what the learning should be. And so the idea is these are teaching opportunities. The more we think about our public outreach as pedagogy, the more we think about ways of getting people involved so they can gain those practical capacities to then, in a sense, become part of that broader community of practice. Because as I said, once you're part of the broader community of practice, lots of things that from the outside look like contestable opinions turn out to be incontestable facts. Because once you understand the procedure, you really can't rationally disagree with them. Not that there aren't disagreements in science, but they're disagreements like that. You know, whereas the disagreement outside is like this. So it's a narrowness of the disagreement, and that's the thing. I think it's often very hard to communicate to people who don't necessarily have that shared practical context. So think like an educator.
Thank you. And I'd just like whoever wants to ask a question to introduce themselves first.
Hello, I'm James Lee from Ohio State. I have a question.
I graduated from Michigan State. I'm sorry.
Oh, man. what would be your, how would you distinguish between a fact and a theory?
Excellent question. You will notice that in the entire talk, I avoided the word theory like the plague. And part of the reason I did that is precisely because that is a word that is so contested across different modes of knowledge production, sort of what a theory would actually be. Let me put up one of my slides again. It's probably easier to sort of run it through the four part here. Cool. All right. So if we want to ask the question, what is a scientific theory? There are at least four answers, because there are at least these four different kinds of epistemic registers in which we talk about science. So if you are a neo-positivist, then a theory is a hypothesis, right? A theory is a hypothesis that either has not yet been tested or has yet to be falsified, but has not yet reached a certain level of significance where we can provisionally accept it. Right, so that's kind of how a neopositivist would understand what a theory is. A realist would not understand a theory that way, because for a realist, a theory is more of what was called an inference to the best explanation, by taking a series of observed things and talking about the conditions of possibility or the mechanisms that would underlie how those work. Now, do those have to be verified? Yes, but not falsified in the way that a neopositivist would treat it, right? So a theory, if you're a realist, isn't a guess that has to be falsified as much as it's the best version we have at the moment, and future findings may invalidate it, but the goal is not to falsify as much as it is to verify, right? So there's a difference in terms of those. If you're an analyticist, right, if you're a rational choice theorist or something, or if you're, you know, you're doing like Weberian ideal types, then a theory isn't either of those two things. A theory, if you're an ideal type person or a model person, a theory is a baseline, and then the actual world deviates from the baseline. A theory is a tool you use to explain why it deviates. Right? Properly used, rational choice theory isn't about rational behavior. Rational choice theory is about the things that don't look like rational behavior. Rational, as a baseline, gives you a sense of what matters in a particular situation to push it off the rational path. Right? So that's very different, because then you wouldn't treat it as a falsifiable hypothesis. You would treat it as instead sort of that baseline. And for reflexivity, theory, right? Theory is a set of experiential vocabularies that allow you to interrogate your own position and characterize where it is that you are located. So think about feminist vocabulary about patriarchy and the way gender roles play out. Right? Those are theories not in the sense of being hypotheses, they are theories in the sense of it being a vocabulary that sums up certain positional experiences and allows us to situate ourselves in relation to them. So what a theory is and what a theory means and what you do with it differs greatly depending on how you think scientific knowledge is supposed to be produced. Which is why, in the talk itself, I wanted to kind of avoid that question and focus more on this notion of sort of facts and factual consensus. The other reason I wanted to not talk so much about theory is because when, especially, we're talking about making the case for science, theory outside of the practicing community of scientists often is understood as something you made up or something you're guessing about. What people want is facts. I said, okay. Well, let's examine how facts work, and let's sort of treat it that way, right? How we ourselves as researchers use theory, I think, is going to have a lot to do with the sort of different methodological positions that we end up taking. And I don't think that's a totally exhaustive list, but it's a nice list of four that I've been using for many years, and I'm perfectly happy to entertain notions of other kinds of science than those four, but at least those are the four that I've come up with for the moment. So I guess you could say that's a theory, too.